This partisan divide in the United States has widened to a chasm. Legislators vote along party lines and rarely cross the aisle. Political polarization is personal too, and it's making us miserable. If you feel as helpless as I do, you will welcome so gladly and gratefully as I do our speaker, Peter Coleman. Peter Coleman is professor of psychology and education at Columbia University, where he holds a joint appointment at Teachers College and the Earth Institute, and directs two research centers. He is the author of Making Conflict Work, Navigating Disagreement Up and Down Your Organization, and The 5% Finding Solutions to Seemingly Impossible Conflicts, among his other books. Please join with me in welcoming Dr. Peter Coleman.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me well enough? I'm going to turn this on, and that'll probably help. Is that better? Oh, raise the whole thing. Yes. Okay. Yes. Let's try that. That's right. I'm a long way from my microphone. Am I not? Is that better? A little better? Yeah. All right. Very good. Thank you for coming out on a Monday, Sunday morning, rainy Sunday morning. I am a peace builder and a mediator, and work in peace processes in different kinds of domains. And so I've been heart sick now for the last 10 days to see what is possible, what we can do to each other, what we tend to do to each other. It does feel like such a big backslide from what we had hoped to see in the future, but I'm hoping it's temporary. And what we're going to talk about today is not unrelated, because it is about our capacity or incapacity to see the other, whoever they be, as humans, right? And to connect and to value them, even if we fundamentally differ on important issues to us. So that's what we'll talk about. I wrote this book, The Way Out, published it last June. I started to work on it because when Donald Trump was elected and political rhetoric got uglier and uglier in this country, there were many organizations that were mobilizing to try to help people communicate, tolerate one another across the political divide, but they were oftentimes, I think, misinformed. They didn't understand the nature of the problem, and some of the remedies that they were offering backfired, which is what the Pew tells us, that these days, when Democrats and Republicans sit down and talk to each other, the majority of them leave more frustrated and more alienated from each other. So it's not just about getting together and talking. It's about doing that under certain conditions, and that's what I want to talk about today. That's the kind of research I've done for the past 25 years. Let me give you a little bit of the background. The idea of American exceptionalism, I'm sure, is familiar to you, and polarization is no different. We're, over the past five decades, we have reached a place unlike most other nations who have also struggled with tensions between democracy and autocracy and other types of left-right tensions. But we are unparalleled in this. This is just a visual of other clusters of nations and the US. And our pattern of political polarization, whether we're talking about Washington, D.C. and the capacity for our leaders to work together, or we're talking about attitudes on the ground, has been growing and escalating since the 1970s. So we're on a runaway train. And it's a highly concerning place to be. The statistics are bad. This came out last November, but half of Americans feel that they've been alienated, feel a divide in their own families. 68% of Republicans believe that the election was stolen from Donald Trump. 80% of Democrats believe that eligible voters are being denied to vote, in contrast with 16% of Republicans. Democrats majority Democrats believe the Republican Party's been taken over by racists, and the majority of the Republican Party believe that Democratic Party has been taken over by socialists. So that's the context. What's even more frightening is that vast majorities of both Biden voters and Trump voters see members, officials from the other party as presenting a clear and present danger to American democracy. So just hear that language, because that is the kind of language that we've been hearing in places like Europe recently. 41% of Biden voters, 52% of Trump voters favor their state seceding from the Union to form their own separate country. 30% of Republicans, 11% of Democrats say that they're ready to resort to violence to save the country from the other side, that they're the biggest threat to the country. Not our economy, not climate change, it's them. That's 40 million Americans in a country with something like 400 plus million guns and more every day, 80% of which are owned by members of the right. So this is what I'm going to talk about today is something that I call toxic polarization. I'll define what that is. But this is a decades-long pattern, and it's a highly addictive pattern. And we know this from research, from brain science research, that outrage and the taste for retaliation is an addictive substance. It lightens up. If you do fMRI research on the brain, you see the same parts of the brain that are triggered by heroin, triggered by a taste for outrage and retaliation. So it is an addictive substance that many businesses and leaders are aware of, and so they play into our addiction. And it's making us sick in many ways. Historians like John Meacham really see direct parallels between today and the 1850s in America, just before the US Civil War, because of the secessionist attitudes of some groups, major disinformation campaigns, and then distrust of the electoral process. 70% of Americans feel that violence is likely, and our political leaders are not in a particularly good position to do anything about this, because half the country sees Joe Biden as, you know, the enemy, and there is a lack of trust in them. And oftentimes, many of these leaders, as you know, just make matters worse because it's politically expedient. Fortunately, we can. Groups like this can, and that's what I want to talk about. That's why I wrote this book. So I'm going to just talk a little bit about this thing, toxic polarization. I'm going to talk a little bit about the science of how we got stuck on this decades-long pattern. And mostly, I'm going to give you sort of five ideas about what we can do about it, what you can do about it in your life or in your community or even at the national level. Ready? Does this sound good? Make sense? You with me? Okay. So I just want to be clear, polarization is not a bad thing. Polarization is just a natural thing that happens in science when there's like an energy field and there are two poles and you're either attracted or repelled. So it's a thing you see in physics and electromagnetics. And in politics, particularly with a two-party system, it's a good thing. In fact, in the 1950s, there was a feeling that the Republican and Democratic parties were overlapping too much. There wasn't much clear distinction between them. And there was a call for a need for more polarization for a healthy democracy, because it's good to have different sides of positions challenge one another to try to find better solutions. But today, we're in a space that looks like this. This is just an image from Twitter. It's sort of moral conversations on Twitter. And what happens is Republicans ruminate and vilify the other side, and Democrats do the same, and there's very little contact between them. So this is the kind of state that we're in, which is what I would call a toxic state. Let me just be clear about how we got here. So when I wrote this book, I went deep on the science of how people study political polarization, extreme forms of polarization, extremism. And there's a lot of research, a lot of really good research. And they identify a series of what I would call kind of micro-level factors, which is everything from brain sensitivity differences. So conservatives' brains are wired to be more responsive to threat than progressives are more responsive to opportunity. authoritarianism in terms of attitudes. There's a host of things at the kind of micro-psychological level. Mostly what you hear is moral differences, that they have different moral priorities than we have. And there's truth to some of that. But there's also all of these macro-level structures. The fact that we have a voting system that forces a dichotomous choice at the end, right? One winner, one loser, means that every 2 to 4 years, we're put into this place that sorts us, right? But you also see algorithms that sort us on the internet, so we're intentionally being sorted, we're intentionally being outraged by the internet because it's the basic business model that keeps them in business. Gerrymandering is part of it. Inequality has a clear connection, correlation with political polarization. So there are many macro level structures as well. What I hold is that none of these account for a 60 now year pattern of polarization. What happens is when these things start to create and feed each other, right? When our beliefs and our feelings about another group are reinforced by the people that we do talk to and don't talk to, by the news we choose to watch or don't watch, by the internet content that's sent to us. And these things start to create patterns that are bigger than us. They're bigger than just how we feel about them or what we plan to do, what our attitudes are about them. It is a kind of ecology that we start to live in. And over time, these things become immensely complicated. So there are structures at all levels, at the business level, at the community level, all the way down to our psychology and our neuropsychology, right? Our neurological structures get wired in certain ways. And these things feed each other, and they create this like cultural riptide, which is really, really hard to overcome, even if you're trying to speak with your sister and doing everything you can and trying to really talk to yourself. It's so difficult because we get pulled away from them in so many ways. This is a kind of a problem that the philosopher of science Karl Popper called cloud problems. He made a distinction in our world and in science that there are two kinds of problems. One are what they call clock problems, which are the problems we have with our cars and our computers, where you can take it apart and fix the part of the printer that's broken and put it back together and it functions again. And that's how we tend to think about many issues, even policy issues or social issues, that if you can find the thing and fix it, it gets better. If you can just get people to sit down and talk to each other, it gets better. But when it's a cloud problem, it doesn't work like that. These work in different ways. There are a constellation of things that are interacting in strange ways and pulling us apart. So finding the thing or a few things to fix is the wrong way to think about the problem, right? When you have a dynamic like this, where you have a set of elements that are working together, that eventually settle into patterns. Eventually these settle into patterns which become habitual. So political polarization today, toxic polarization today, is a lot like an addiction because it's a biopsychosocial structural problem. It's within our own, at some point, it's in our own biology and neurology. It's in our psychology of who we're comfortable and not comfortable with. It's in our relationships. It's in our networks. It's where we choose to travel and not travel, who we hang out with and don't hang out with, the news we watch. It scales all the way up to our political system, right? So this is the nature of the problem we're dealing with, is what Popper would call a cloud problem. And thinking about fixing this by doing any one thing or two things is the wrong way to think about it. Fortunately, we've studied these things, and there's a lot of research in mathematical modeling coming out of physics largely, which is looking at these kinds of problems as complex systems. And so this is out of applied mathematics, but there's also psychologists and anthropologists that work with this lens. And so there are a lot of papers looking at polarization and tipping points, looking at how complex systems like this, patterns, long-term patterns, get stuck for decades, and the conditions when you see them change dramatically. And what is there, what happens, what is there that we can do to encourage that kind of change? So that's what we've been doing. We've been recommending that people think differently about these kinds of problems, because our typical approach of having people just come together, which is based on something called contact theory, which came out of race relations in the 1950s, and is an excellent thing to do most of the time, unless you really believe that they're evil. And then sitting down together and having one talk, mention Trump and the other vilify Trump, blows up, doesn't go anywhere. So we have to think about how to address this problem differently. So we've done a lot of science on the study of what we call intractable long-term conflicts like this, a lot of empirical science that, of course, nobody reads, so we write these books, like The Way Out. So that's what I've done in writing this book, is try to communicate this in ways that are useful to people, right? Not in scientific jargon, because it's alienating to most. All right, so the good news. The good news is that one of the things we study and others study are when you have deeply divided societies like ours that have been stuck in either civil wars or international wars for long periods of time, what are the conditions where they actually stop and pivot and change? So we studied those, and there are three things to be mindful of. First is that you need to have enough of the middle that are exhausted and fed up and want a way out, right? That just don't want the dysfunction and screaming and the vitriol. They're just tired and burned out, and they were looking for some other alternative. So the good news there is that this group, which is called More in Common, it's a UK survey group, they've been studying us, and they find that there are what we call the hidden tribe. So you have both extreme wings of people that are true believers, but then you have what they call the exhausted middle majority, this group within the middle, which is the vast majority of Americans, somewhere between 67 and 86% of Americans today say they've had it. They don't want this anymore. They don't think it works. They don't think screaming and hating each other is getting us anywhere, and they're worried about the future of violence. This is a newer poll from Pew, and they find about the same kinds of ratios of those in the middle that are fed up. So that's the good news. The good news is we're miserable as a country, that most people have had it. And another condition is that the society needs to be sufficiently destabilized. What we find is that long-term divided societies often change a few years after major, what they call political shocks, major destabilizing forces. It might be a coup assassination attempt, or the end of the Cold War was a political shock for many. Fortunately, we've been living through multiple political shocks, spikes in awareness of racial injustice, COVID, the Great Resignation. People are really rethinking their lives. And so this is an opportune time for people to think differently about where we are in this situation and what to move forward. So we've got two of the three conditions. The third one is we have to have some sense of what to do. So you can be miserable and feel destabilized and questioning, but you have to have some sense of what the alternatives are. And that's really why I wrote this book. What I do in this book is I cherry pick five areas of science, five principles from science that has implications for you and your life, has implications for your family, for your community, and your nation. These things are principles that scale, that operate at different levels, and that have been found to help societies change, help individuals, families, and societies change. So I'm going to give you a quick taste of that, and then we'll move to questions, okay? I'm just going to give you, there are chapters on each of these in the book, but let me start with the first one. So again, after some kind of political instability, like we're either coming out of or in the midst of, it's very important to make an intentional reset, to really think about what your next steps should be, could be. This is true for addicts, right? Addicts hit bottom, or addicts, there's an intervention where their family says, we won't help you anymore. And at that point, the next step matters. Do they reach out to a sponsor at AA? Do they join, do they change people, places, and things in their lives? So it does require us to take that time to think intentionally. And so I talk in this chapter about a variety of ways to do this. Let me give you one example. And this is from research on complex systems that, again, when they destabilize and reset, the first things they do, even the assumptions they make matter. So there's research out of Israel-Palestine looking at the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And what they find is that our assumptions about the other, ourself, and the situation matters. If we believe that they're never going to change, you know, Palestinians are never going to change, Israelis are never going to change, the situation's never going to change, then we either disengage from the problem, or if we have to engage, we fight, right? Because those are our only two options. But if we believe that they, whoever they are, and let's say Republicans for now, or Democrats, if we believe that they're not all the same, there are some that are open to different kinds of conversations. There are some that are not. We think about this in terms of Russia right now, right? That there are Russian people that are not happy with this situation and not comfortable. And if we don't see them as a monolith and we believe that there are people there that are willing to change, then our orientation to them is different. And we engage with them potentially in different ways, right? We don't only fight them. We see that there's a possibility for change. So that simple assumption in your life with your family or with members of your community in terms of our divides here matters. Do you believe that they can change? And if you don't, what does that mean for your options, right? Okay. The next thing I will say is that it's important in problems like this, instead of having some new idea or process come in, and this I've consulted with the Biden transition team on this because they were planning a big Unite America campaign, and I just said, you know, you don't need to launch a campaign. What you need to do is recognize that there are already thousands of groups in our country today that are doing this work in ways that are informed by science and are careful. So there are dialogue groups across this country that are what we would call positive deviants. They're groups that, even under times where most of the country hates each other and sees the other as the threat, are bringing people together and kind of systematically helping them have conversations, but move beyond conversations. There are people that, there are groups that understand there aren't quick fixes for this. It isn't go and have an hour conversation with somebody and we'll be fine. It's recognizing that these are hard conversations, they take time, they need to be facilitated, and ideally these groups move into some kind of joint action together, because that's when you start to see relationships become thicker, but those things take time and they take support. So the good news is, you know, there are many of these groups across the country. This is a piece I published in The Hill on this. If you go to this website, which is the Bridging Divides Initiative out of Princeton University. They have, for the last 2 years, been collecting information on bridge-building groups across the country. And there are, to date, somewhere between 7,000 and 10,000 of these groups that they've mapped. And this is an interactive map that you can zoom in on and see where are these groups and what kinds of work do they do, and is it evidence-based, and, you know, what are the effects of them? This is our neighborhood right now. It's like we've got the measles. We've got a series of groups right around here that do this work, that try to bring people together intentionally, systematically, right? But also recognize that it's not a quick fix. It's part of a solution. All right, complicated. I'm going to say three more things, and I'm going to step down. So this is largely what we do in our research. We have a lab at Columbia called the Difficult Conversations Lab. And for about 15 years, we've brought people together who are divided over some moral issue, who have different sides on an issue, pro-life, pro-choice, climate change, you name it, Trump. And then we study the conditions under which those conversations go well or go poorly. And what happens when we're polarized is that we start to simplify. We start to see them as this, all the same, we're all the same, it's clearly we're victims of their craziness, right? And that's comforting to us, but it's also the problem. So complicating your life is one way to start to try to address this. So what research shows is that if you can intentionally attempt to not just get information and engage with others that are comfortable around these issues, but intentionally choose to challenge yourself. So one of the things I do when news breaks is I have about a half dozen people that are on the other side of these issues, usually, who I think are decent, smart, well-informed people, and I fundamentally disagree with them. And I track them. I follow them on Twitter. I follow them on the news, because I want to know, from a broader perspective, what is the information here? Not just the information I find comfortable in reinforcing in my beliefs and values. I want to know what others are saying, and is there value in that? It's hard to do, especially when emotional things happen and you really feel that there's an egregious wrong, but it's critically important for making better decisions. That's what the science tells you. And one group that's doing this right now are reporters. There's been a movement organized by a group called Solutions Journalism for several years now, and what they're doing is they're trying to get reporters to recognize how they, in their reporting, contribute to polarization. Why? Because they're trying to get a story that gets eyeballs, right? So they say, okay, here's a conflict. What are the two sides? Who are the most provocative people? Let's bring them on television and have them scream at each other, because people will watch that. But what does it do? It just, you know, you don't process both sides. You process one side and you hate the other side, and it contributes to polarization. So they've been trying to think about, they wrote a piece, Amanda Ripley, a colleague of mine, is a journalist, wrote a piece called Complicating the Narrative. And this is strategies that reporters can use, and editors, and publishers of newspapers and other news accounts, that help them think about how do you do reporting in ways that doesn't prematurely oversimplify things, provide enough context, but still make it compelling. So it's a challenge to all of those business models, which you see thrive in times like Trump, because there's so much energy around hating the other. So how do you mitigate that? That's what they've been trying to do, is complicate their approach to reporting. Okay, two more. So one of the things that we've found in our, so I'm a mediator and a peace builder. And so what I usually do when there's a conflict is I bring the disputants together, we sit down, they talk, and we try to do everything we can to come to an understanding. And most of the time, that's great. It's not, as I said earlier, it doesn't work with these kinds of deeply entrenched cultural conflicts. Then you need to do something else. And one of the things we found is the power and value of movement, of people getting up physically and moving together, or working together, or cooking together, or protesting together, or whatever it is. If people get up physically and move together, what neuroscience tells us is they develop a sort of synchrony between them. It's a neurological process where they start to feel a little more compassion for one another. You see this with dance troops. You see this with combat soldiers who march together. There is a kind of empathy and connection that is built that can be used in bridging divides. So one of the things I do when I'm having trouble trying to talk to somebody from the other side who I feel is obstinate is I say, would you go for a walk with me outside? And if you walk together side by side outside, it has an impact on opening you up, opening them up, and connecting you in kind of surprising ways. It's science, it's physiology. And it does help us emotionally, at least free from our patterns. And the book has a variety of stories and examples of this, and I won't go into it now, but there is something in the Middle East called Abraham's Path, which is a journey that you can take, and they encourage interdenominational groups to take this. And it's Abraham was, of course, the founder and father of the three major religions, and they encourage people to walk that path together, outside, side by side, as a way to begin to connect across difference. And then the hardest thing I'm gonna say is this. My daughter read this book. By the way, both of my kids went to Ethical Culture and Fieldston, so I'm from here. Yeah, thank you. I can't take credit for it, but they all went through here. Hannah, my daughter, read The Way Out. And she called me afterwards and she said, I think this is a great book, but I have to say it's a hard book, particularly that last chapter where you say adapt. Because what I say in this chapter is what I've been saying to you from the beginning, is that there are no quick, easy fixes to this. It isn't going to be about Biden saying or not saying something. It's not going to be about a dialogue talk. It is going to it is recognizing that these kinds of problems, like this is Israel-Palestine, oftentimes are very complicated, and you may do something that you think is well-intentioned and it backfires or it has unintended consequences. So it does require a mindset that this is going to take us a while. This is, again, a 50, 60, 70-year pattern that it's going to take concerted efforts from the top, from the middle, and bottom up. And what we've been calling for is more of a movement. It does need a movement like AA, right? AA has groups around the world with a set of basic principles that allow people to change people, places, and things. Well, we have the infrastructure for that because we have thousands of these groups, but we don't think about it at that level. We need to think about it at that level because, you know, addiction is a chronic illness. Well, this may be chronic for us in our time. We have to come to terms with that, but not give up. Recognize that there are still things we can do. So the book ends with a set of nudges or new rules that are gleaned from these principles that I just talked about. I won't go through them, but they're all there. And there's a website for the book that has a bunch of exercises and ideas and reflection questions that you can use as well. That's my story.
Great. We have an opportunity for you to ask questions. As always, if you're in the room, raise your hand. Wait until you get the microphone to speak. If you have a question on Zoom, write it in the chat.
Yeah, real quick, just so everyone on Zoom can hear.
Yeah.
They didn't pick you up. If you're on Zoom, feel free to type your question in the chat. We'll read it out here. And everyone in the room, please wait for the microphone so that everyone on Zoom can hear your question.
So Vince is first, Amy. In the red ball cap right here.
So thank you very much, Mr. Coleman. So I absolutely concur with you about the 1950s, but the 1950s...
1850s.
Well, you said the 1850s?
Yeah, 1850s was just before the Civil War. That's
we were
what
close
John
together in the 1850s. Is that what you said?
1850s, yeah.
You said that was when we had a lot of disruption. I thought you said the 1950s was the last time we were close together.
No, I said the 1850s is a parallel that historians are drawing to today because of the conditions and the concerns. The last major cultural ruptures we had were the late 60s, early 70s, right?
And I agree.
Yeah.
And up to the 50s, what I was going to say was I think that we were really forged together by the Depression and World War II and the Cold War. In fact,
yes.
As early as the 1970s, the political forces got together and passed the EPA and the Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act. And they were thinking of themselves as Americans, not as Republicans, Democrats. Barry Goldwater was an American when he went to Nixon and told him he had to resign.
Yeah.
So a unifying factor was not one of the three ways out you said, just as a comment.
Yeah.
That was my question number one.
Yeah.
And the other thing I mentioned to you is I don't have a solution for what's going on today. You probably do. But how much is the problem that we have now a result of the fact of the way people are educated in this country and not taught to think or read papers or consider things?
Yeah, education is critical. So let me start with the first question about unifying forces. So I don't know about you, but I was surprised that we suffered a pandemic and it didn't unify this country. It was weaponized and became a political issue and still to this day is a political issue, right? So there usually is what they, in my field, that we call it disaster diplomacy. If there are ethnic groups that are killing each other and a tsunami comes in and wipes out their communities, oftentimes they put down arms, they help rescue, they help rebuild, and that can really change the dynamic between them. So we have seen that in the past here. We didn't see that now. And one of the reasons is because I believe that political polarization is a first order problem. It's how we interpret all the threats. I mean, what's heartening about, I can't say heartening, what I was glad to hear about what Americans' response to what's happening in Ukraine is that there's bipartisan support against this invasion with some exceptions. 25% of Republicans see this as Biden's fault. So even an issue like that, right, that we're on the verge of a world war, is still weaponized. So it's true that usually there is some kind of event that brings us together, but not when you've got this deep cultural divide that is the filter through which we understand everything else. So that's that's a major challenge. And we have major challenges like climate change, for example, and the clock is ticking or the clock is over, But so it's not that we don't have these kinds of crises, but it's how we understand the crises, how we respond to them that is problematic. Education is critical. And I agree with you that we need to take a hard look at how we educate our groups. And there are two things I'll say about that. One is, so Costa Rica is a nation that is one of the most peaceful nations in the world. Costa Rica in 1948 came out of a bloody civil war where thousands of people were killed, and they intentionally said, we don't want to do this ever again. And they divested their military, they reinvested it in the economy and ecology and education. And part of what they did in education is they mandated what they call peace education in all of their schools, which meant that all children learned conflict resolution, respect, tolerance, those basic things as their core curriculum in their schools. They believe that they were able to grow a more peaceful society and tolerant society. Now, obviously, it's a more complicated story than that, but they really see that kind of cultural effort that is the resocialization of population of your population over time that is a critical thing. I think that's really true. But I will also say, as a member of the Academy at Columbia University, that there is an extreme bias to the left. There is a lot of hate and intolerance for the right, and that's a problem, right? And again, there are a lot of reasons for that, but recognizing the need for both of those, to have a curriculum that is more inclusive and respectful and gives people the skills to differ more effectively, as well as being able to somehow begin to tolerate, particularly in academia, where you're supposed to be able to challenge ideas, that's sort of our mandate. If that shuts down, we're in big trouble. Okay. Yes.
Thank you, Peter. This is fascinating. Thank you for the presentation. I have two big questions about, one, the concept of polarization and what contributes to that and the way out.
Yeah.
So when it comes to polarization, I'm wondering, what is your take of, because you've been talking about Democrats, Republicans, what's your take of the impact of polarization within the Democrats and within the Republicans, and what role cancel culture plays to that?
Yeah.
About the and then the question about the way out, the silent, I would call it silent majority of people that are in the middle,
yeah,
right? I'm wondering, what role do you think personality traits of being agreeable or disagreeable, of being comfortable having difficult conversations or not,
yeah,
will play into have that silent majority breakthrough? Because I think that might be one of the challenges that I have envisioned in my limited experience with people. People who are on the far left or far right, usually, and they're very vocal, they feel very good in conflict.
Uh-huh,
They thrive, right?
Yeah.
So, those two things.
Okay, a lot in your questions. Let me start with fractionalization of both parties, right? So that's part of what we're seeing on both the left and the right, right? Because you have a pro-Trump and anti-Trump conservative group. The numbers are still pretty strong for Trump, but declining. But there are major divides there, right? As well as on the left, or in Democrats, or in progressives. And there are a lot of divisions there. What's ironic here is those divisions can help us as Americans in that they can kind of introduce more nuance into the understanding of both sides. But they also oftentimes are reasons why people go after the other side, right? There's a in science, there's a thing called two-level game theory, and it's saying that what's happening domestically, for example, for Vladimir Putin, is a major factor in why he's driving a war, right? It's a way to throw attention away, right, to not take responsibility for the kind of government that he set up and the inequality that's there and put it on someone else. And so the problem with sometimes these fractions within parties is that they mobilize more vitriol against the other side because that's a unifying dynamic, right? But again, you know, I think there are healthy divisions within the left and within the right. Cancel culture, in my view, is a pathology, but it's on the left and the right. I mean, the right created cancel culture, you know. We just, it's now called that on the left. But kind of shaming and shutting down dissent, again, it's a typical dynamic that happens. It happens, you know, any of you that were here during the Vietnam War, particularly World War II, you know, you don't talk positively about the enemy. You don't challenge the status quo in times of threat. So there, you know, you do people under these kinds of tense situations, there is a lot of sanctioning and controlling of your in-group, right? And to some degree that makes sense, and that is an artifact of the conditions that we're in. Sometimes that can actually help, but right now it's out of control. It's really out of control. And on both sides, I think it's acutely problematic. Did I answer, what was the second part? Oh, yeah. So, yeah. So, I mean, I'm a social psychologist, which, you know, and there are personality psychologists and people that believe in environments, the power of environments and conditions. I'm not a big fan of personality psychology because I feel like it essentializes people, and I think people are always more complicated than that. It's often true that we'll say, oh, you're an authoritarian. Well, you may have those tendencies vis-a-vis another group, but it might be that that's how you are at home, but you're not that way at work. Or in a volunteer organization, you give that up. So people are more complicated than that. Yes, if we crudely look at authoritarianism, for example, you see more of that on the left and the right, right? And on the left, on the extreme lefts and the rights, they are much less tolerant of the other. And they're much more engaged in politics and controlling the discourse. 80% of the content on Twitter comes from 10% of the participants. And the rest of us are sitting around listening to this story and believing that it's true when it's really extreme versions of our world. So there are, and you know, the middle, this middle is, as I said, 80%, 90% of the country. So it's really hard to essentialize who they are. I mean, what the More in Common group does in this hidden tribe studies is they try to provide profiles of who the disengaged, exhausted middle are and the next out, all the way to the wings. And the wings are clearly controlling the story these days, and re-engaging the middle in democratic processes is part of it. But what I will say about conflict is, you know, that's my thing, right? I study conflict. Conflict is just a naturally occurring thing that happens in life like sex. The question is, when does it go well and when does it go poorly? And so conflict can be something that people learn to become more better at and more comfortable with because it can help them in their life, right? So yes, there is a maybe some kind of conflict avoidance. I think it's usually disillusionment with our institutions. We don't believe in government, media, tech, or business anymore. All of our institutions have lowered, so people disengage, and it's exhaustion. So I think what we do need to do is give people a clear sense of what are the levers that they can do to have an impact, and working with groups that are doing that effectively is one step. Yeah, I'm sure there's more to say, but I'll leave it there. Yes.
I just have a quick question. So I think that it may be in the best interests of certain groups or powers to keep us polarized as a country. So, you know, to your point of getting two warring factions, factions on a talk show.
Yeah.
So how optimistic are you of overcoming toxic polarization? How optimistic are you for us as a society?
Yeah, thanks, good question. So I am optimistic, but I think the work is hard. And so in some ways it's not like, yeah, we're gonna get through this, no problem. we can do this, but the work to do it is really going to take effort, and we have to realize that, or we'll get disillusioned and give up, right? But I just want to say yes. So one of the things I talk about in the book is the business model of internet, major internet platforms. They're all based on competition, confrontation, provocation, because it taps into that brainstem stuff, and it is an addictive quality. You know, Facebook started because Zuckerberg was angry at a girl and did this thing about social comparison in some ways to humiliate her, and that's the basic business model of Facebook. And they say, well, we want to connect the world, but it's like, well, how are you connecting the world, you know? They're connecting the world in competition and provocation and contention, and sometimes it's weaponized as, you know, in the worst, you know, types of atrocities. But even at its basic model, all of them, that's the coin of the realm. If you say something snarky and critical on Twitter, it goes viral. If you say something hopeful, we study this. If you say something hopeful or promising, unless it's cat videos, people are much less interested because it's not as addictive, right? So the business model of social media is part, they know this. They've known this for a long time. And they're very slow to affect their market share, right? But that's true, frankly, with CNN and MSNBC and you know, Fox and Breitbart, all of these groups. They know what is addictive. Roger Ailes knew what was addictive substance. It's the loudest voice in the room, the most contentious, entertaining character in the room. And so it's part of our society and our culture to tolerate that. It can be affected by the government instituting regulations. There are really smart groups starting to think about how to mitigate these effects. I think the biggest lever that we haven't yet mobilized is us. I think if there is a mass uprising to say, you don't do this to us. I mean, this is happening with Facebook and Instagram and its effect on teens, right? And the whistleblower that came out and said, what's her name, Marie Hogan?
Yeah.
Who came out and said, you know, they know this. They're poisoning your daughters. Their suicide rates are very high, you know. So there is an inclination when you start to realize the intentionality of how they're making our world more toxic to mobilize us. I think that there's all kinds of power that we have as consumers to say, you know, either change this or we're out. So it has to come, pressure has to come from all of those areas. It's not gonna just come from the government. The government doesn't even understand the internet, let alone know how to regulate it. We have to fight the addiction ourselves, absolutely, and mobilize our communities like this to really say no more. I didn't bring copies of the book, but it's on Amazon. It's all, you know, any place you buy books, they have them. They have them locally in the stores. And yes.
Yeah, I want to get to a couple of questions on Zoom here. I think you've answered some of them. Let's see here. So Cindy asks, can you speak more in detail about the effect of economic inequality and polarization?
Yeah. So again, there is a ton of research on this that is really important, but it's not the only problem because there's inequality all around the world. Our inequality is at historic levels. Our rate of inequality continues to grow. And so it is this major force. And it's a major force, if you think of, you know, Bernie Sanders' group and the Trump populace, most of them, you know, are outraged about inequality. So there is a common driver around polarization and what the right solutions or responses are to that around inequality. So there's robust research that connects rising inequality to vilification and tribalism. But what I say is, even understanding that is insufficient. What we have to understand is how that feeds everything else that I've been talking about. Because there are different ways to respond to inequality, and political tribalism is how we're doing it mostly. I do want to say, I have to say one quick shout out. There's a group in Congress called the Select Committee for the Modernization of Congress. So Congress has this mechanism that they use every so often when they're really broken. And it's called the Select Committee. And usually they put them together for a year and they say, this is a problem, figure it out. They brought a group together about a year and a half ago to address polarization in Congress and in politics. And they've been working. These are, you know, a Republican and Democrat co-chair it. Six and six are on the committee. They share their budget. It's consensus decision making. They're trying to walk their talk. And what they've been doing is thinking through what are the structures that are contributing to this in politics and in society, and what are the levers that we have. They went to Pelosi with 98 recommendations for how to change the incentive structures to make Congress more functional. Here's two things they did. One is that for freshman Congress people, when they come in, the day one, they show up in DC, they put them in a red bus and blue bus, and they drive them in different directions and have them start war councils. So they said, don't do that. Give them a week to understand the magnitude of the responsibility that they have and the decency of other people that are joining them, and begin there before you move into war councils. Or they recognize that everything that Congress people do these days is on camera. Everything they do is on camera. So they're never talking to each other. They're talking to their base on camera. So they said, give them spaces, give them places where they can go where there are no cameras, where they can start to have different kinds of conversations, not just, you know, political tirades. Okay.
One more question.
Okay, so this one touches on your conflict resolution work. Jenny and Michelle ask, to what extent is it helpful to say, I disagree with my group on this, and I agree with your group on this? Does that work as an opening, or is, you know, what's the effectiveness of that as a sort of in with in dialogue?
Yeah, so it is, when I talk about complicating things and finding, you know, what we call contradictory complexity in ourselves, that's what I'm talking about. I am talking about when I watch the news and I seek out these people that have different political opinions from me, it is an attempt to complicate my thinking and feeling on an issue. So, and then again, for me to speak up on that in my group may have consequences for me. It depends on your group, right? But it definitely may have consequences. But better that than just bad decision making, you know, rumination and vilification and oversimplification of what's an increasingly complicated world. So it's a critical thing that we do. We're usually not comfortable with it in this country. In this country, I have, you know, colleagues from Europe that come over and they'll come to parties and they'll say, why don't people ever talk about politics and parties in the US? And I say, well, it's because if you look around, you may have one or two dissenting vote, but everybody else is on the same team, right? That's how we socialize here. And that's different in Europe, which is kind of interesting and provocative, right? Where they take politics differently and there are these cross-cutting structures. So yeah, let me end with one thing. There's an article in The Atlantic about a place called Waterton, New York. Waterton, New York is upstate, middle of Trump country. Went very strong for Trump in both of the last elections, and is in the 1% of the most politically tolerant counties in the country. Politically tolerant. Like, what's up there, right? Well, one of the things they have is many more mixed Republican-Democratic marriages. There used to be many more of those in this country. They've declined to about 10%. Waterton has about 25% of couples differ. And that means that their kids grow up with different points of view. So that kind of complexity and the tolerance for difference that comes from being raised in an environment like that are the kinds of structures we need to think about. The Times had a piece not too long ago about how we're physically moving away from each other, right? Reds and blues are moving toward, you know, blues towards blues and reds towards reds and away from each other. And they had an interactive map. And again, if you look at the Upper West Side, we're deep blue, right?
But if you look across the river, not too far away, there are purple places. There are places that have, you know, people living together. Visit them. Go there, you know, please, you know. That's where we have to start.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.